Good morning, First Church. How is everybody this morning? Let's all stand and begin our worship this morning.
That you would bear my cross. cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life.
Father God, I thank you so much for the amazing grace. I thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for us. Lord Jesus, we do sing for all the love that you give to us. Thank you for the day that you've given us today, and thank you for everybody here that we can worship your name this morning. Lord, as Dave comes and prepares a message for us this morning, I pray that our hearts and our minds will be open to receive your word. We love you, and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name that we pray, amen.
So Job was one of the first ones to ask the question. Now, it's been asked by millions since, but it's never really received a completely satisfactory answer. Why do good people suffer and wicked people prosper? Job couldn't understand why the cattle of the ungodly were multiplying while he'd lost his entire herd. Why were the homes of the wicked kept safe while Job's son, his home collapsed in a fierce windstorm? It distressed Job that the children of his unrighteous neighbors were dancing around in their front yards, laughing while all 10 of Job's children died in that disaster. Job asked, why do the wicked live on, growing old and increasing in power? They spend their years in prosperity and go down to the grave in peace. Yet they say to God, leave us alone. We have no desire to know your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? What would we gain by praying to him? Even though he didn't understand why, Job held on to his faith and responded, the Lord has given, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Haven't you asked the same question? If God is all-loving and all-powerful, why do bad things happen to us when we're trying to be good? I mean, you study long hours to grind out a passing grade while the cheater breezes through with honors. Your womb is barren while another unwed mother aborts another baby child. You try to rear your children to know the Lord and they rebel against him while the child of an atheist becomes a preacher. Why do the righteous suffer and the unrighteous prosper? Since the age of 7, I've had epilepsy. It continued to plague me on into my late 20s, and it really severely limited the things that I could do with my life. I remember when I went off to Bible college, college consists of a lot of late night studying and getting up early for class. But one of the biggest things with seizures is that you really need your sleep. I can't even say how many nights I got on my knees in my dorm room and I would pray to God, God, why won't you heal me? Why do I have to suffer this way? I'm trying to become a messenger of your word. Can't you see that this is limiting my ability to serve you? During my senior year at my weekend ministry in Maysville, Kentucky, we put together this lock-in. We rented out the YMCA. We had a band come in. And it was a really successful event. We had over 100 kids there. I knew what would happen as a result of having this lock-in because of my seizures, you know. So I prayed to God. I said, God, please, just maybe just stifle my seizures just this once so that I can do the event and that the event could be a success. As you can imagine, I was a mess after the lock-in. I was having seizure after seizure after seizure. The following couple days were pretty rough for me. When I finally did recover, I lashed out at God. I said, God, I asked you for one thing. I was so angry with him. I just didn't understand. Well, looking back now, was the event not a success? Did God not use me despite my weakness? I mean, I got an answer. It just wasn't the one I wanted to hear. Have you been there? At the time when we're in the middle of our suffering, it just doesn't seem fair. I mean, why wouldn't God bless those who serve him and punish those who are defiant? And we have to be careful when thoughts like that creep in, because we can develop this mindset of, well, why bother then? I mean, we wind up giving up on our faith because we can't see what God sees. Our vision is just so limited. Like Job, we have to put our trust in God that our suffering is not in vain. And that can be really difficult sometimes. The Bible does have answers. Simon Peter wrote about the reason for suffering in 1 Peter chapter 4. Now, this passage doesn't answer all questions for all times, but it does give us some helpful insight into the mind of God about human anguish. It teaches us first that some suffering is inevitable. Expect it. 1 Peter 4:12 says, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you." Some are surprised when they experience suffering. They just say, you just don't think this will ever happen to you. They're shocked and unprepared for what seems like an impossible nightmare. Some get bitter and they shake their fist at God and accuse him of being totally unfair. There are plenty of people that something rather traumatic happened to them in their youth, and they feel like God didn't answer their prayer, so now they reject Christianity and the Bible. But Peter's more realistic. Don't be surprised when you face suffering, because that's normal. Pain comes from at least 5 different sources, 2 of which are mentioned in this passage, and we should expect it. Sometimes we suffer because of our Christian testimony. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, don't be surprised, verse 14. Believers in the first century were often insulted for being a Christian. They were called unpatriotic because they weren't loyal to Caesar. They were called cannibals because they ate the body and blood of Jesus. They were even called incestuous because they loved each other as family. Persecution happens frequently today to Christians living in other countries like North Korea, Pakistan, Iran, and India, just to name a few. Christians to us in the United States, we're to somewhat of a lesser degree also ridiculed for our faith. Christians are often mocked on social media platforms, TV shows, and radio programs. So don't be surprised that Jesus' prediction comes true. If they hated me, they will hate you. Sometimes we suffer because of our own sinful behavior. Verse 15 says, "If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer, thief, criminal, or meddler. The lawbreaker is sentenced to prison and they're punished. The meddler loses friendships, and that's their own fault." Sometimes we suffer terrible diseases or indebtedness, loneliness, and humiliation as a result of our willful disobedience to God's instructions. Now listen, I grew up in the days of belts and switches. So for those of you who don't know what a switch is a small, thin branch that you are sent out to the yard to specially pick out, break it off the tree, and take it back in to get a whooping with. Now, my brother and I were what you might call frequent flyers. So we would keep a couple spare pair of underwear hidden outside in a stash, and when Mom would send us out to the yard, we would go to our stash and put on our extra padding and head back inside. I'm pretty sure that I was just a casualty of the ongoing war. You know, my brother was, he seemed to always be the one getting into trouble. And I was just with him. I guess maybe I was guilty by association. I don't know. But anyways, the Bible says don't be surprised that be sure your sin will find you out. Sometimes we suffer because of a satanic attack. Satan brought one painful trial after another into Job's life. The Apostle Paul said that his thorn in the flesh was a messenger sent from Satan to torment him. Sometimes we suffer a direct hit from Satan, and we don't know what's going on. We're blindsided. Some can take this idea to the extreme, though, and attribute every problem in their life to a satanic attack. They sneeze, and the allergy demon is attacking. They're late because the traffic jam demon got in the way. I mean, come on, seriously, you sneeze because you probably have allergies. You were probably late because of poor planning. But Satan does seek to kill, steal, and destroy us. And we shouldn't be surprised that he sometimes inflicts pain. Like Paul, many of you in this room have your own version of a thorn in the flesh. Remember, God tends to use our weaknesses to build us up in other areas of our lives. My seizures taught me that ministry is a team effort, that it should never lie solely on one person's shoulders. Even Jesus had 12 disciples. We have to work together as a church to advance the gospel. To be honest, my seizures also, they kept me humble. Sometimes we suffer because we live in a fallen world. Adam and Eve introduced a sin virus into the world, and now we live with the consequences of their disobedience. The Bible says that all creation is now groaning. It's out of alignment. Philip Yancey wrote that since Genesis 3, we live on a stained planet. There are dangerous bacteria, cancer-causing agents, hurricanes, floods, and drunk drivers in the world. The Bible says the rain falls on the just and the unjust. And sometimes it falls in inordinate amounts through hurricanes that can hit one section of the country 4 times in a row. Christians aren't exempt from the natural disasters in this world. Jesus said to his disciples, "Those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. Those 3,000 people who died in the World Trade Towers didn't die because they were worse sinners than others. They simply lived in a world where people suffer because the world is contaminated by sin and sinful people. So don't be surprised that Jesus' prediction comes true. In the world, you're going to have trouble. Sometimes we suffer because of God's discipline. Hebrews 12:6 reads, "The Lord disciplines those he loves. A caring father is not going to allow his children to be defiant for very long. He will discipline them and inflict temporary pain to correct their dangerous behavior. And our Heavenly Father sometimes punishes us to get us back on track. When Jonah went in the opposite direction of what God had commanded him, he suffered a terrible storm at sea and barely survived 3 uncomfortable days in the belly of a fish. I'm sure when Jonah was finally vomited up on shore, I'm sure he was like, 'God, okay, I get it. I'm going. I'm on my way.'" Hebrews 12:10-11 says, "Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it." Growing up, I got made fun of quite a bit, as if the grocery store runs on the moped with 4 people weren't bad enough. No, it actually gets worse. I'd say elementary through about 7th grade, the only clothes that my brother, sister, and I wore that weren't homemade were our socks, shoes, and underwear, and thank goodness Mom didn't know how to make those. We looked ridiculous. Mom would take us to this store called Mays Fabrics, and we'd walk in there, and she'd be like, "Oh, pick out something that you like," and we'd sit there like, yeah, let me tell you something. There are no good options when the best picks are sunsets or flowers. I kid you not, my mom made me wear an outfit to school. I was covered in matching shorts and shirt and shorts, covered in sunsets all over me. Do you have any idea how hard it is to make friends when you are dressed like a tourist in Hawaii, or you look like you're wearing something that could be your retired Floridian grandmother's curtains? It's pretty tough. Sometimes you hurt because you disobey, and sometimes you hurt because your mom thinks she's a fashion artist. Most of the time, you won't be able to pinpoint exactly why. You wonder, is God pruning me, or am I just experiencing the fallout of living in a sinful world? And even though you're not sure, you shouldn't be surprised. You shouldn't be surprised that it's happening. It's not strange. It's not unusual. It's inevitable. The second lesson from this section is that all suffering is purposeful. Rejoice in it. Verse 13 says, "Rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed." When you hurt, you can appreciate more deeply what Jesus endured. When you suffer physical pain, you can better identify with the excruciating pain that shot through Jesus' body, from the thorns that pierced his head to the spikes that went through his hands and feet. When you suffer emotional stress, imagine what Jesus endured. He suffered severe daily stress. He encountered hostile critics, slow learners, incessant demands, and constant interruptions. When you suffer alienated relationships, remember, Jesus' own brothers mocked him. Judas betrayed him. And Simon Peter, he let him down in the clutch. Everyone abandoned Jesus when he needed their support the most. None of us in this room or watching online can possibly imagine what Jesus must have felt from the moment that trial started to when he took his last painful breath. When I was about 8 years old, I got trapped in my sister's closet. I couldn't get out for hours. It was dark, I was scared, and I was alone. But I knew at some point that someone would eventually come home and rescue me. Jesus would have no earthly rescue, and he knew it. When you hurt, you have the opportunity to mature. Verse 14 says, "If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you." We all experience suffering and hurt in our lives. In our moments of weakness, we may feel like the entire world is watching, but God uses our weakness to make us stronger. Think about it. When you're at your weakest, hurting the most, you trust God more. You pray more. You read Scripture more. Your faith probably seems deeper at that moment in your life than any other period. James wrote, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." When you hurt, your opportunity to witness is enhanced. Verse 16 reads, "If you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name." Suffering puts the spotlight on you. People will watch to see how you're going to react. Suffering enhances your credibility. People will listen with a more attentive ear. Think about it this way. We're all sinners. Romans 3:23 makes that very clear. "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." But Romans 3:24 gives us hope. "They are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Your daily battle with sin makes you stronger. But rarely does someone go through a battle and not be left with scars. Those scars give you credibility. Some of us are, quite frankly, ashamed of our scars. We've hurt others. Others have hurt us. We've even hurt ourselves. My scars serve as a reminder of the hope that I have in Jesus, that I've been made perfect through his sacrifice. They also allow others to see that my faith has been tested and is very real. And when people speak to me about their personal battle with sin, they know that I can relate, because I'm not walking around acting like I've never made a mistake. Now, does that mean I walk around like an open book, just there for anyone to read? No. It also doesn't mean that I can relate to every sin. But what it does mean is that I know what it is to be broken. I know what it is to be hurt. I allow the Holy Spirit to use my testimony to reach those who are lost. Through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, I can see people's sometimes very well hidden scars. I can say, "I understand you're hurting. Let me help you. Let God help you." They can see that I'm not there to judge. I'm simply trying to show them what God's love and forgiveness looks like. Suffering is inevitable, and we should expect it. Suffering is purposeful, and we should even rejoice in it. But notice one other thing. Patient suffering is commendable, and we should trust God's justice. Verse 17 says, "For it is time for judgment to begin with the family of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome? What will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God?" God is going to administer justice someday. The righteous who have suffered patiently will be commended. James 5:11 says, "As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy." God rewarded Job's endurance by giving him twice as much at the end as he had at the beginning. We're promised in Scripture that if we're faithful in suffering, one day God will honor us. It may not be in this life, but when Judgment Day comes, it will be a day of glory for all those who have proven faithful in their suffering. However, the wicked who have prospered and never given God glory will be punished. If it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? If it wasn't easy for the righteous to be saved, it cost the lifeblood of Jesus to accomplish that. If the ungodly reject that sacrifice, they will receive their lifelong request to be separated from God for eternity. Verse 19 says, "So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good." The term Creator emphasizes God's sovereignty and care. He's in charge. He will bring about justice. Have faith in Him. He's the one who designed you. You are His masterpiece. He wants what's best for you. Put your trust in Him. There's a story of a father who's this train operator who sits on a stand and throws switches for the trains to pass by. One day he brought his four-year-old son to work with him, and his boy wandered out on the track and got his foot caught, and he couldn't get out. He was stuck. 400 yards away is a passenger train that's coming right for the young boy. It's coming so fast that it can't possibly stop. But the father could throw a switch that would surely crash the train, killing all 50 people on board. What should he do? It would be a tough choice. But what's the wise choice? The unemotional choice. Most of you would probably say that he should sacrifice his son. I mean, it would be hard, but it would be the right choice. But let's take that a step further. What if the boy were the next Billy Graham, and he would save millions for eternity? Or he was going to discover the cure for cancer? Or what if the next Billy Graham were on that train? No one could make the wise choice except someone who could see the future of all those on the train and the boy on the track. That's why, since we aren't capable of making that choice, we have to do the best we can and trust God, that He will bring about the best possible results through the best possible means for the most possible people for the longest period of time. That's a lot of possibilities. The word commit is a banking term. That means to deposit for safekeeping. You commit yourself to God, trusting that He will keep you safe. And since we cannot see the future, we can only trust God's providence. We say, "Lord, I don't understand why I'm hurting and why this is so ongoing and so severe, but I still believe You are my Creator and the Savior of my soul. I'm going to keep serving You because I believe that Your word is true, that all things work together for the good of those who love You." So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good, verse 19. Some of you are going through painful times right now. You may feel imprisoned. You may be battling depression. There's no word from God, and you're starting to wonder if maybe He's punishing you or maybe He's just forgotten you altogether. You may be beating yourself up for those times that you've surrendered to the wrong desires or made the wrong decisions. You may feel like a failure. Don't give up hope. God has not forgotten you. Chances are He's poised in heaven, ready to welcome you home and give you the highest award, the crown of life, and say, "Welcome home, good and faithful servant." So hold on. Life is hard, but God is good. He's going to make all things new and right one day. Why do bad things happen to good people? The truth is, there are no good people. Sure, some are worse than others. But remember Romans 3:23. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all deserve punishment. We're all unworthy. But the gospel message is that there is a good God. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, so that whoever would believe in Him will not perish but have eternal life. John 3:16.